last meeting, we discussed about how the plan of salvation was laid out in the sanctuary and the services. And we discussed also about the spiritual applications of the articles of the furniture found in the sanctuary. And today, we're going to take a look at some of the materials that was used in the constructing of the furnishings and the walls, the coverings, and all this of the sanctuary, and we're going to discover what their spiritual application is and their symbolic meaning and how it makes clear to us what it means in Psalm 77:13 that God's way is in the sanctuary. But before we go any further, let's go ahead and pray, and then we'll get started, okay? Father in heaven, Lord, thank you for reminding us that this is your world and that we are your creatures, both by creation and by redemption, Lord. And thank you for everything that you do for us. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you that he is alive and that he is at the right hand of yours right now, interceding in our behalf. And we pray, Father, that his intercession will not be in vain in our behalf. And we ask that the Holy Spirit be present here with us to not only speak to our hearts, but to show us how to take and put into practical use what you say to us. In Jesus' name we ask this and pray and thank you. Amen. In our scripture reading, we read about some of the materials that was used, and it was listed the materials as to what was going to be used. So let's turn our Bibles back again to Exodus chapter 25. Exodus chapter 25. Before we take a look over here at Exodus chapter 25, I want us to take a look at something. Have you ever wondered exactly what it means in Psalm 77:13 when it said, "Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary"? Everybody, ever bother yourself to think what that meant? What does it mean that God's way is in the sanctuary? It comes from the Hebrew word, derech. It means course of life or of moral character. So what the whole purpose of the sanctuary service was is that not only was it to reveal the plan of salvation to us, but it's also to show us how we are to become like Jesus and to be perfect just as Christ is perfect. If anybody doubts that we can't be perfect like Jesus, then there's something seriously wrong, because the Bible says, "Be ye perfect." And it also says, "Be ye holy, for I am holy." Perfect does not mean maturity. God is not immature, so he doesn't expect us to be immature, and he himself is mature. But when it says perfect, it means exactly what it means. The word means perfect. Without spot, blemish, wrinkle, or any such thing, as Paul says in Ephesians chapter 5. Now, in of ourselves, there's no way we can be perfect. We cannot live a life free from sin. It's not possible. But with Jesus, we can. And so this is why it says that it's a course of life or a moral character. Our characters are not like Jesus, but as we study the sanctuary, its furnishings, the materials used to construct it, we're going to discover how we can become like Jesus. So let's take a look now at our first main point. In Exodus 25, we've read about who had given the specifications on what the children of Israel were to bring as a freewill offering to the Lord, right? So let's take a look again at Exodus chapter 25, verse 3. And notice how it starts out in verse 3. It says, "And the Lord spake," excuse me, I was reading verse 1. "And this is the offering which ye shall take of them, gold, silver, and brass." Why does it start out with gold first? Why not brass? Why not silver? What is gold symbolic of? We know that gold is symbolic of the deity of Christ. It also represents perfection. And you know what's interesting is in Revelation it talks about buying gold tried in the fire, doesn't it? Revelation 3:18, which represents Christ's character being perfected in our lives. And in these materials, we see that they're exactly listed as God specified in no other way. And it tells us also that nothing could be left to chance or man's imagination, that when it comes to making it back to heaven and being redeemed from the earth, we have to follow the specifications that God has given us in the Bible, and the Bible alone. We can try to do things our own way and try and think that we can make it to heaven our own way, but we'll always come short, because remember what Jesus said in John chapter 14, verse 6. He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father but through me." And Peter tells us in 1 Peter 2:21 that Jesus left us an example that we should follow in his footsteps. So if Christ is our example, then the best way to understand how Christ lived before he came and as how he lived when he came the first time is to take a look at the sanctuary. So here we see that our main point here is that our Heavenly Father expects us to approach him according to the way that he has laid out, and there is no other way. And we see this clearly right here in Exodus, because remember in Exodus chapter 25, verse 40, he told Moses, he said, "Be sure that you build everything according to the pattern that was shown to you in the mountain." They were given a blueprint that they were to go by. And if they would have deviated to the slightest degree, would that have been a replica of the heavenly sanctuary, of which the earthly was a replica of the heavenly? No, it couldn't have been. We've also been given a pattern too. That pattern is found in our Lord Jesus Christ. And if we want to make it back to heaven, then we have to follow that pattern to the complete letter as well too. And so, now, let's take a look at our second point. But before we talk about that, I want to share this with us. You know, it's interesting about pure gold. It says, pure gold throughout the scriptures speaks of divinity, that which cannot be reproduced by man, and gold is made by God and comes down from God. Gold speaks of the deity of Jesus. It typifies the divine glory of our Lord Jesus. And what is it that's holding God from coming back to get his people right now? The Bible tells us, and the Spirit of Prophecy both tells us, that when Christ's character is fully reflected in his people, then he will come back for his people. So, is Christ's character being fully reflected in our lives? Nobody can answer that question but ourselves, and God knows whether or not his character is being reflected in our lives. And what we need to be doing is we need to be praying earnestly like never before. In this anti-typical day of atonement, pleading with God to remove any and everything out of our lives that's hindering Christ's character from fully reflecting through us. Sometimes we may not realize some of the things that we do or say because there's such a habit that we're misrepresenting Jesus. And sometimes our eyes are blinded because remember, Paul says that the God of this world has blinded their eyes that they should not believe the glorious gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Sometimes our eyes are still blinded as well, too. And so what we need to pray is that God will reveal to us any and everything and remove any blindfolders that the devil has over our eyes that's hindering us from fully reflecting Christ's character. Because the longer it takes for Christ's character to be reflected and perfected in his people, the longer it takes for Jesus to have to come back. He's not waiting for the mark of the beast to be enforced. He's not waiting for the seven last plagues to fall. He's not waiting for all these other things that are happening in the world before he comes back. He's waiting for his character to be reflected in us, his people. So, to a large degree, we are responsible for the prolonging of Christ's second coming. And if we want to hasten the return of Jesus, then let us pray like never before that God will take our lives and empty us of self and fill us so much with the Holy Spirit that every time we do or say anything, it's Christ in us, the hope of glory, speaking in and through us and not ourselves. And now let's take a look at some other things that gold also represents in the Scripture. Let's turn our Bibles over to Malachi chapter 3. Malachi chapter 3. Malachi chapter 3. chapter 3, verse 3. We should all be very familiar with this verse right here. And it says, are we all there? Okay, Malachi chapter 3, verse 3. And it says, and he shall set as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. So one of the things that gold represents is our characters and faith tried in the fire. Do any of y'all know how the refining process for gold goes? They put the gold into the furnace and they heat it up until it becomes liquid, and they leave it there until something happens. And you know what that is? You know when the refiner knows that the gold is purified and it's ready to come out of the furnace? When he can look in the gold and see his own reflection. That tells us that, again, Christ is waiting for his character to be fully reflected in his people. And Jesus is longing, with great longing and anticipation, for his character to be fully reflected in us as his people. And we need to allow his character to be more fully reflected in us than ever before. Now let's turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And let's see what the Apostle Paul has to say to us about what gold represents in the Scriptures. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 12 to 14. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 12 to 14. Are we all there? Okay. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 12 to 14, we read the following. It says, now if any man build upon this foundation, what foundation is Paul talking about? He's clearly referring to the Lord Jesus Christ, because if we build upon any other foundation, we're not building upon the right foundation. And Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7 that if we do not take heed to his words and do as he says, we're like a man that builds his house upon the sand by the seashore. And it's a dangerous thing to build our houses upon the shifting sands of this life, because sand is very unstable and it is not solid at all. It doesn't take much for sand to give way and become weak. But if we build upon the firm foundation, the solid rock of our salvation, our Lord Jesus Christ, no matter what comes against us, we'll be able to stand firm, because it's Jesus in us and through us and not ourselves that is trying to do the work. And he goes on to say that if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble. Verse 13, he says, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire. And look what else he says. And the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. So we need to be careful what we're building upon this foundation, because this gold that was used to make all the furnishings of the sanctuary was pure gold. And not only was the furnishings of the sanctuary made out of pure gold, we're told that even the walls and the floor was made out of gold as too. Well, actually, the walls, not the floor, excuse me, but the walls were made out of gold as well too. And the earth made new, in the New Jerusalem, we're told that the city is going to be made of streets of gold. It's going to be transparent gold. It's going to be so pure that it's going to be like looking through a glass. We've never seen such pure gold before. I know I haven't. I would dare to say that nobody sitting here present today has ever seen such gold like that. That's going to be amazing. We're going to be walking on streets of gold. And so here we see that pure gold throughout the Scriptures, like I mentioned a while ago, it represents the divinity of Christ. Not only the divinity of Christ, but it also represents Christ's character perfected in us. And also, another interesting thing about the gold that was used in the building of the sanctuary is, it tells us that it is of value. God does not waste his time on anything or anybody that is of no value. And I'm pretty sure we've all heard the old saying, God does not create junk. All of us are worth and value in the sight of our Creator and our Redeemer, or he would have never sent his Son on such a costly errand to redeem us. And here's some interesting things too. You know, all the furniture, I mentioned this, I'll go ahead and mention it again in case nobody was listening. Above the holy and most holy place was made of solid gold. And everything represents the recognition of the perfection of the character of Christ when he left the outer court, which was the earth. And it also signifies our character, which is the gold tried in the fire and is achieved through receiving the Holy Spirit. As he writes the law of God in our hearts, let's take a look at Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 33. And when God gave the Ten Commandments to Moses in Mount Sinai, who was the one that wrote the commandments? Was it Moses that wrote down the Ten Commandments? The Bible tells us that God wrote them with his own finger upon tables of stone, right? Now look what Jeremiah tells us. Who's going to be the one writing law, God's law, his moral law, the Ten Commandments in our heart? Is it going to be ourselves? No. Look what Jeremiah tells us in chapter 31, verse 33. Are we all there? Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 33. And it tells us, but this shall be the covenant that I shall make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their inward parts, and I will write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. So, it's interesting that God, when he gave the law in written form, he himself wrote it down upon the tables of stone with his own finger. Then once we're born again and we accept Christ as our Lord and Savior, it's God that does the work in us that brings about the perfection of Christ's character. It is he that writes his law upon our hearts. We can't write God's law upon our hearts. The natural man doesn't even desire and want to obey God's law. Paul tells us that the natural man is at enmity with God. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. And now let's take a look at something interesting about the gold. Does anybody remember, or does anybody know how much gold was dedicated for the sanctuary and its furnishings? It was 2,800 pounds of gold. That's a lot of gold. 2,800 pounds of gold. I didn't take the time to see what the modern day equivalent of how much monetary value that would be in our time and day, but I'm pretty sure it would be in the millions. And that's a lot of gold. 2,800 pounds of gold. That's quite a bit. And so the main point that we learned about the first material used in the construction of the sanctuary and its materials and furnishings is this. That there's three important points gold is symbolic of. One, and the third important thing is that gold can also symbolize the following: perfection, faith, and love tried in the fire. And so we must remember that everything that was used in the sanctuary and its services, as well as the construction of the sanctuary, has very important things to say to us, not just literally, but symbolically, as well as spiritually too. Because gold is the most precious and valuable of metals in the world today, is it not? Who should be the most valuable and precious person in our lives? Shouldn't it be our Lord Jesus? He alone should be the most valuable and most important and precious person in our lives. Because he alone is worthy to have that complete loyalty and allegiance of our lives and hearts, is he not? Now let's take a look at what the Bible says silver represents. You know, throughout the scriptures, we're told silver figuratively represents and speaks of redemption. How do we know that for a fact? Let's turn our Bibles over to Leviticus chapter 27, verse 3. In Leviticus chapter 27, verse 3, we read the following. Leviticus chapter 27, verse 3, it says, "And thy estimation shall be of the male from 20 years even unto 60 years old, even thy estimation shall be 50 shekels of silver after the shekel of the sanctuary." So how is it that silver represents, and is figuratively speaking of, redemption? Let's turn our Bibles to Exodus chapter 30, verse 16 now. And let's see what it says to us in Exodus chapter 30, verse 16. Are we all there? Exodus chapter 30, verse 16. And notice what Moses says to us in Exodus 30, 16. "And thou shalt take the atonement money of the children of Israel, and shall appoint it for the service of the tabernacle of the congregation, that it may be a memorial unto the children of Israel before the Lord, to make an atonement for your souls." So here we see clearly that the Bible says that silver is symbolic of redemption. And that redemption, we know, is found only in Jesus and Jesus alone. And what's interesting, too, is, does anybody know how much silver was used in the dedication of the sanctuary service? And it's the sockets that was made for the gold boards? I've jumped ahead of myself, actually, there. So we know that Scripture speaks of silver as representing redemption, and as always used as redemption money. But here's what I was going to get to, and we know that redemption is only found in Jesus and Jesus alone. And silver also prefigures the preciousness of Christ as the ransom for sinners. And you know what's interesting is silver is not mentioned in the heavenly sanctuary and the earth made new. Do you believe me? Don't take my word for it. Let's go to the Bible and see what it says in Revelation chapter 21. When it talks about the materials that's used of the construction of the new Jerusalem. In Revelation chapter 21, it talks about the various pearls, the various precious stones, that's used to make up the foundations of the wall. It talks about the streets being made of gold. And it talks about pearls at the 12 gates. But what's interesting is nowhere does it mention silver. Ever wonder why silver is not mentioned as one of the materials used in making up the foundation walls and the construction of the New Jerusalem? Remember, silver represents or is symbolic of redemption. So those that are redeemed from the earth are already redeemed before Jesus comes back the second time. We've already allowed Christ to perfect His character in us and to remove all sin out of our lives. So therefore, when Jesus comes back, He's not coming back to redeem us from our sins because He's already done it. And those that are in the earth made new are going to already have sin removed out of their lives here, and there will not be any sin found in the earth made new, and there will be no need for redemption in the earth made new because it's already been accomplished in this life right now. Understand what I'm saying? Amen. So this is why silver is not mentioned in the earth made new, because we've already been redeemed by the blood of Jesus. And so now let's take a look here at what I was talking about earlier about how much silver was used in the construction of the earthly sanctuary and the materials in the sockets used for the gold boards. The gold was 2,800 pounds of gold. The silver was almost five times more than the gold was. 9,600 pounds of silver was used in making the silver sockets that the gold boards that made the walls of the sanctuary were to sit in. So that tells us that Christ didn't think twice about the value that he placed upon us when he came to redeem us. We're of such great value that there's nothing in this world that should replace the value of one soul. Even if just one soul, if we had to give up all that we had for one person to be saved, would we be willing to give it all up for them to be saved? Or would we be willing to just continue to hold on to it and ask God to find some other way to save that individual? Jesus gave up his life for us. He died so that we could live. And he gave all for heaven. He gave all for us, and all of heaven was poured out in that one gift, we're told, in the Desire of Ages. And so now, let's take a look at what the main point is about what silver also reminds us of. It tells us here that silver is symbolic of the redemption that comes through Jesus. It also prefigures the preciousness of Christ as the ransom for sinners. And it also symbolizes obedience, redemption, and prayer. And here's another interesting thing, too. This was from Prophets and Kings about what Ellen White says regarding what Jeremiah said in Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 30. Let's turn over to Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 30. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 30. Are we all there? Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 30. And I would encourage you, if you have a Bible, to actually follow along and read it for yourself and not just listen to me read it, please. Because it's good to see for yourselves what God has to say instead of just taking what the minister says all the time for face value. Go back and study the scriptures for yourselves. Don't just listen to what I'm saying. Search it out for yourselves to make sure what is saying is being said is correct and 100% in harmony with the Bible. And don't just accept what the minister says. Double check. Be a Berean. In Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 30, look what we're told. It says, "Reprobate silver shall men call them, because the Lord has rejected them." Another word for that word reprobate would also be the refuse, the dross of the silver. So this tells us that if we don't allow Christ to perfect his character in us and remove the dross of our earthliness, it could end up causing us to be lost. And if we're lost, whose fault is it? Is it God's fault? Or is it our own? It'd be our own, because he's done all that he can to redeem us and to set us free from the power of sin and Satan in our lives. And here in Prophets and Kings, we read the following from page 410. It says, "As a wise master builder, Jeremiah, at the very beginning of his life work, sought to encourage the men of Judah to lay the foundations of their spiritual life broad and deep, by making thorough work of repentance. Long had they been building with the material likened by the Apostle Paul to wood, hay, and stubble, and by Jeremiah himself to dross. Refuse silver shall they call them, shall men call them, he declared of the impenitent nation, because the Lord hath rejected them." Jeremiah 6:30 margin. And now she goes on to say the following: "Now they were urged to begin building wisely and for eternity, casting aside the rubbish of apostasy and unbelief, and using as a foundation material the pure gold, the refined silver, and the precious stones, faith, obedience, and good works, which alone are acceptable in the sight of a holy God." Brothers and sisters, there's nothing that we can do to earn our way to heaven. And just as God specified the materials that was to be used for the constructing of the furnishings and the walls, the sockets, the materials to be used, God said that for a purpose and a reason. And God is a God of order, and he expects us to follow what he said to the complete letter. And if we don't follow it to the complete letter, it can cause us to miss heaven. And why would we want to miss heaven for anything in this life? The day of Christ is drawing nearer and nearer as we speak, even at this very moment. Things are transpiring in this world and changing so fast that if God was to withdraw the angels that are holding back the four winds, we would see a time of trouble, as the Bible says, that has never been experienced since there has been a man upon the face of the earth. And God in mercy is holding back those winds because so many of us are not ready. Let us not be the ones that are responsible for holding back, for him having to hold back those winds anymore and to prolong Christ's return. So let us do our part to help hasten the return of Jesus and to plead with the Lord like David did. He said, "Lord, search me and try me, and know my thoughts, know my heart, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Is that y'all's desire? Amen. Father in heaven, as we've looked at these, what the gold and the silver represent in the construction of the sanctuary and its furnishings and materials and the walls, we pray, Father, that it will help us to have a clearer and better understanding of your desire for us to have the golden, perfected character of Christ in our lives and to allow him to remove the dross of our earthliness. As we draw nearer to the second coming of Jesus, Lord, we pray that you'll give us a greater desire and willingness than ever before to allow you to help us to rid our lives of all sin out of our lives and out of our hearts by submitting to the working of the Holy Spirit and allowing him to have full control of our lives. Be with us the rest of this Sabbath day and bless us and help us to remember that the Sabbath consists of more than just a few hours at church, but it's a whole 24-hour period. In Jesus' name, we thank you and pray. Amen.